Please remain standing for the reading of the Gospel. Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea, and Trachonitis and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is the good news given to us.
Thank you, my brother. Will you pray with me? Rain down upon us, Lord Jesus. May these words and all the words spoken in this time of worship open us and move us and free us and turn us around to know you and to serve you now and forevermore. Amen. When I was a little girl, my Thanksgiving day was marked by two rituals. The first ritual had to do with the Macy's Day Parade. Now, yes, it was in black and white for a little bit for me. But I loved watching the Macy's Day Parade. And the other end of it was after dinner, when Mama and my aunt would be putting the food away, and I'd be on the couch, and I probably was supposed to rest or something silly like that, but something had just come to the house in the mail. It was the Sears and Roebuck catalog. Oh, you know what it is. I was ready to explain to some of you millennials what it is, but you know, I'm so relieved that you know. But if you don't, it's like a phone book. Okay, so I got that part said. I'll know where I am in my notes. So, but in that catalog, I would find the toy section, because that's all that mattered to me, and I would look for the one special gift that I would ask for that year. And I would wait and wait to see if my hope was met. Wanting and waiting are our companions on the Advent pilgrimage, are they not? So what is it, if you're really honest, what is it that you want for Christmas this year? What is it that you are waiting to receive? What is your one precious gift, your hope? If you're nauseated by the commercialism and all that goes on from, I think it's starting at the 4th of July some years, with all of the Christmas preparations, if that just gets your goat, because this season that was once a season of quiet, solitude and penitence, of waiting and wondering what it means to be seeking the salvation of the Lord, a time of pouring out one's heart in the darkness. If you want that time again, then you must just love the second week of Advent when John the Baptist comes on the scene. He is my favorite nativity scene character. He is, I know he's not there. I haven't lost it completely. He is my favorite nativity scene character because in the coming of Emmanuel, he comes as well. Luke gives us a very beautiful reading about John the Baptist. If you compare what the Gospels say about him, Luke tells us, he reminds us, this is the priest's son, Zechariah. Luke ties him to the inherited hope of a people who have walked through the wilderness and lost their way. For a moment, though, I want to peek into Matthew, because Matthew really has the good stuff on him. Matthew is the one who tells us Luke wore a shirt of camel hair, and that's really itchy stuff. Luke ate locusts and honey, and Luke is not just in the wilderness for his own good. Luke is there crying out, repent and believe. Yes, we want John the Baptist to remind us of what this is about. We need the image of John the Baptist to be flashed up on TV screens and all the monitors we have in our lives, on our phone screens, on our iPads and iPods and our satellite things, on our GPS things in the car. We need John the Baptist to surround us like those scenes in the Hunger Games where there are scenes that are mandatory messages. We need John the Baptist to surround us and to cry out to us, repent and believe. He is in the wilderness with the people who are waiting and wanting, because that's where people go, who are waiting and wanting. He's in the wilderness crying, and he is with the other voices that are crying. What voices do you hear crying in the wilderness today? When I think of the wilderness, I think of the places where abandonment rules the day. I'm reminded of the sieges of confusion and chaos and dissolution that rule the day. It's not very Christmassy, is it, in the wilderness? There's no hot cocoa or snowmen or stencils of the word joy to put on our coffee cups. The wilderness is a barren place. Perhaps he ate locusts and honey because that's all there was to eat in the wilderness. Yet he stays there. He stays there and he calls out to the people. Believe, repent, the valley will be exalted, the crooked will be made straight, the low places will be filled. One of the things I want for Christmas is not to have to go to the wilderness. The voices crying, their cries are a result of the angst and anger of the world, churning and churning with destruction and discord. I hear their voices. Do you? I hear the voices of Syrian refugees, of the people of Israel and of Palestine. I hear the voices of all veterans of all wars. I hear the voices of all of those in the places that have been torn apart by violence, whether it is violence in the home or violence in the neighborhood or violence in the nation. I hear because my own daughter's voice is among them, I hear the increasing voices of those who cry, Black Lives Matter. And I hear and read the voices of those who are so uncomfortable with this cry that they want us to only say, All lives matter. I hear their voices day and night and in my sleep. I hear the voices of those who have cried so long, they're hoarse. They're trapped in addiction. They're trapped in sex trafficking. They're trapped in injustice in the judicial system that believes it is just. What I want for Christmas is for these voices to not ever have to cry again. When we begin to listen to the voices in the wilderness, when we cock our heads and lean that direction, our wants become very real. The waiting for redemption becomes very palpable. We wait like Israel for something new under the sun to save us and those we love and even our enemies and all the world. We wait for the light to come charging in the darkest places of despair. We wait for someone like John the Baptist to come and shake us from our paralysis. But John doesn't come to us. He cries to us. He calls to us. He's in the wilderness and he's calling to us as they are crying to us. And like the people who heard him then, we must hear him now and go. Go to where he is, the wilderness. And like those who heard him and began to give up their coats and their worldly possessions and to treat one another differently, we are invited into a different way of being. The word that is used in the writing of this story is metanoia. Turn around. Turn your body and soul and mind around. And really, it's not us doing the turning, but it is the very grace of God that turns us, because we can't turn ourselves on our own. It's not accidental that John is in the wilderness. It's not accidental that we are drawn there this season. The turning that we are called to is to no longer be afraid or overwhelmed by all the voices we hear in the wilderness crying to us. The turning around is to go where we hear the messenger of God. To go into the darkness, carrying the light. To stand in the darkness and reach out and feel the hands of those who are reaching out in that darkness. For together we will touch the hand of God. John calls us to this place of self-examination, to a period of listening very carefully to the cries that we hear. We, my friends, are to be midwives of hope. The turning in our lives is to turn from the safe places where we think we can wait and want for peace without looking toward it. To turn from the self-indulgent places where we can turn care for our own, whoever that is, before we can care for God's own. To turn from our hesitancy to go where the questions are hard. Because we need to go there and we need to be there and live there. It is only when we embrace those hard questions that we will find the way through them in our differences. We are called to turn from nostalgic places where we reminisce about Christian witness as if it were a thing of the past. So today, in the midst of all of our busyness, in the midst of all our worry, and even our own darkness, today, I invite us to go to the rough places and the low places. Go and proclaim that God is indeed in the wilderness, waiting and watching for us, with healing in her wings. Let us go together. In the name of Christ, amen.